I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We're grateful to have so many guests with us this morning, coming from all around LaGrange County, Fort Wayne, Kalamazoo, and even as far away as Chicago. At the risk of not knowing or remembering all the names, I would just like to recognize a couple: Jennifer Tuttle, Beth Sherman, Steve Schwick, and Eva Merkel. Thank you for being with us this morning. Additionally, we are delighted to see some of our trustees and their spouses, our president, Mr. Phil Malone, and his wife, Marge, our treasurer, Mr. Dave Hauser, and his wife, Sue, and Mr. Robert Fanning, and his wife, Sandy, also the Honorable Representative, David Zent. Thank you for being here with us. Let's pause as we begin to open in a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we bow before you today, thanking you for who you are, our Creator and our Redeemer. We come asking you for your blessing upon each person gathered here this morning. We ask for your watch care over our school and our community. We especially pray for our Corps of Cadets. Keep us secure. Guide us to thyself, that we would grow to be good leaders of integrity and strong character. Would you bless our superintendent now and give him the words of instruction and encouragement? I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I am pleased to introduce for our lecture this morning, Colonel James Benson, our superintendent. Colonel Jim Benson began his professional career as a high school teacher and football and baseball coach. However, with the Vietnam War in the news, he felt the calling to lead in an environment where the stakes were higher and there was less fame and recognition, so he signed up for Officer Candidate School and shipped off to Quantico, Virginia for what began a 26-year career as a Marine officer. By summer of 1969, he was an infantry platoon commander in the Quang Nam province in South Vietnam. Before the year was over, he became a company commander and went on to reach rank of colonel before retiring in summer of 1995. At that time, he returned to his education background by serving as the executive assistant to the president and director of planning at Bridgewater College, later moving up to the position of vice president for administration. In his book, Executive Courage, Jim describes his experience as an organizational recovery led by a dynamic president, Dr. Philip C. Stone. In 2004, he moved to Alabama, where he became the 15th president of Marion Military Institute, MMI, a long-time struggling independent two-year college and high school college preparatory school. While at MMI, Jim wrote the legislation that made the institute a state-owned and funded military college and culminated in a dramatic turnaround that solidified the college's future as the military college of the state of Alabama. Meanwhile, he filled over 200 empty beds, dramatically increased the revenue while reducing expenses, and completed a major renovation of the campus and its facilities. Moreover, he kickstarted a dismal fundraising program that raised over $8 million in 5 years. In 2009, Jim was recruited to rescue a failing Riverside Military Academy, a 102-year-old independent middle and secondary college preparatory school in Gainesville, Georgia. With superb facilities and a supportive board of trustees, the academy was failing in virtually every operational area leaving the board with the question of whether to sell the school or try once more to turn it around. Losing millions of dollars annually with over 200 empty beds, bloated expenditures, no fundraising program to speak of, and unhappy alumni and more, Jim began a 7-year turnaround that filled virtually every bed, significantly reduced expenses, and raised the annual revenues from less than $10 million to just short of $20 million. Jim's military career included assignments as commanding officer, Joint Task Force 129 Special Operations and Counterterrorism, commanding officer, 6th Marine Regiment, and Chief of Staff, Assistant Commander of the 2nd Marine Division. A decorated veteran, Jim was awarded the Defense Superior Service Medal, 3 Legion of Merit Awards, 2 Bronze Star Medals with V for Valor, the Meritorious Service Medal, the Joint Service Commendation Medal, the Vietnamese Cross of Gallantry with Palm, 3 Navy Commendation Medals, 1 with V for Valor, and the Navy Achievement Medal. Jim's first book, So You Want to Be a Leader, Advice and Counsel to Young Leaders, was published by Trafford Publishing Company in 2007. The second edition was published in 2013. Jim received a Bachelor of Arts degree from Bridgewater College, a Master of Science degree from the University of Tennessee, a Master of Public Administration degree from Pennsylvania State University, and a Doctorate of Higher Education Administration from the George Washington University. He is also a graduate of the Armed Forces Staff College and the Army War College. Please join me in welcoming our superintendent, Colonel James Benson.
Pulpit is intimidating. Distinguished guests, parents, friends of the Academy, Howe board members, and most important cadets of Howe and Lakeland High School who are with us today, good morning.
Morning, sir.
A special welcome to all of you. We're delighted to have you. Of course, I'm delighted at the size of the audience today, no matter how intimidating. And I have no jokes, no clever openers. I will get right to the point. My main objective today is to give our cadets something memorable about character and leadership that will help them grow into men and women of substance who will become able leaders in a free republic. Of course, with spring break around the corner, a little pre-departure guidance can't be all that bad either. All Marines have a main objective and an intermediate or secondary objective. My secondary objective today, other than speaking to our cadets, is to offer some food for thought for the seasoned leaders and guests in attendance here today. I'm going to talk just a little bit about the spectrum of fear as I perceive it. There are, of course, many kinds of fear and many reasons for saying. I mention fear because there can't be courage without fear. And courage, whether it be physical or moral, is a critical component of our character. Physical fear has been my companion many times. I have been shot at in the mountains, in the rice paddies, in the jungles of Vietnam. I stood at the bad end of the barrel of 8 AK-47s. In the Central Highlands of Nicaragua during the Sandinista Country War. All of these I discuss in great detail in my next book, Executive Courage. But I want to talk to you a little bit about the spectrum of fear and how fear graduates. It starts with concern. And we can have concern about our health, we can have concern about our family, we can have concern about our safety. But it's just that, concern. But it also can grow into stress. We can have stress about debt. We can have stress about having to fly on an airplane. We can have stress about public speaking. We can have stress about grades. We can have stress about our appearance. But then it gets to fear. And fear can be physical, and it can be moral, and it can be executive, and I'll talk about that again in another venue. It can be from combat. It can be from parents finding out what our grades are. It can be about decision making. Do we conform or do we not conform? And it can be about not being popular. And then it graduates into terror. We can have terror or horror resulting from storms, tornadoes, hurricanes. We can have terror from combat. I've experienced that form of fear many times. And then there's rage. And that's when terror becomes so horrible and so horrific. That's where the Medal of Honor is won. I believe in that. I've never read it. But I've sensed being on the verge of rage when you're ready to do just about anything, like those great heroes did, who called friendly fire on their own forces. But cadets, what I want you to do as I'm speaking this morning, I want you to think about, what do you fear most? Is it bad grades? Is it loss of popularity? Is it issues with your family? It's not debt, you're not old enough to have debt yet, hopefully. Is it addiction? Those are the things I want you to think about, because I'm going to come back to you, and I'm going to ask you to rank them as we get further into the presentation. So let me conclude that fear and courage, or I should say courage in the face of fear, join other dimensions of character, which include integrity, sound judgment, and selflessness. And I'm going to move from there to character. My experience in education is that many academicians in public and private schools and colleges consider character a soft skill. But to me, it's not a soft skill. Character is a hard skill. Character and leadership are core competencies at a military academy. Schools where character is the subflooring for leaders' resumes. Why character? According to author and former superintendent of Virginia Military Institute, Josiah Bunting, a school's deliberate effort to train, educate, and develop the character of our students is more important than anything, not equally as important, it's more important than anything we do to develop the intellect of our students. Now that I realize that this statement is at cross purposes with contemporary ideas about the purposes of education, I think of it a great deal more. But an ordinary citizen of sound mind and sterling character is infinitely better, a better product of our academy than a brilliant and cultivated intellectual of flexible character. It is just not enough to educate the mind through the provision of knowledge. We must train the soul. Training the soul means we must cause the formation of personal values and convictions, respect for authority, a willingness to be accountable, not solely for our own performance, but the performance of others. Moreover, we must, once again, ingrain in our students a love of country. Through the study of American history, honor and allegiance to our flag, and more. I recall in ancient history, Pericles' writings about Athenian times, when he cautioned his citizens that they must re-fall in love again with their country. For a number of years, there's been a strong wind blowing in private and independent schools like Howe, where structure and spiritual nourishment is offered to young people in a holistic way. After all, how can we expect the youth of today to be indifferent to material success? Ill-gained wealth, drugs, and the idea that the ends justify the means. If we don't deliberately make the effort to teach them. I don't mean we assume that that by playing sports and learning sportsmanship and so forth and so on, they're learning character. It doesn't happen that way. You must embed it in our curriculum. We must teach character as if it were the be-all, end-all. How they acquire a sound judgment, unless we take the time to correct their misjudgment. I remain struck by the high levels of success of many whose academic achievements and test scores were very low. We have to recognize that functional intelligence, which is wisdom and experiential knowledge, and fixity of purpose, as opposed to the overzealous emphasis on SAT and ACT scores. My heroes were not the best and brightest, as sought almost exclusively by Tier 1 colleges and universities. My heroes were the wisest and bravest. Wisdom, drive, and diligence do not surface in the SAT and ACT tests. Yet in many school systems, those tests and others seem to be the be-all, end-all of our educational purpose. In military schools like Howe, we stand apart by deliberately, in plans and deed, developing the character of cadets to be good citizens, as we once did in colonial times. There is a leadership imperative in military schools. It is our niche, so to say. And I think there's a difference between showmanship and leadership. Showmanship is about self. It seeks popularity, and it is the bed for mediocrity. Leadership is about others. It seeks respect and moves the needle to the right. Showmen are what some call nominal leaders, those who appreciate the status and the compensation and the temporary respect the position deserves, but lack the will to make the controversial decisions, moral and otherwise, that are required to achieve greatness. Real leadership is honed in the furnace of schools like Howe, where our youth experience the challenges of leading peers, fighting against conformity, promotions and demotions, and sometimes the harsh counsel of role models and moral anchors such as TAC officers, teachers, and ROTC staff. Moreover, these cadets feel the thorns of accountability, where at a young age they experience what most never feel until first job post-college. In his fine book entitled The Conviction to Lead, Reverend Albert Moeller put it succinctly: if you lead faithfully, you will make decisions that are unpopular. They are costly and sometimes filled with risk. There are days when you will have to stand up and take blame for the bad decisions made by others, and plenty of other days when you'll have to stand up and take the blame for your own bad decisions. But even more frequently, leaders have to bear the burden of the right decisions they make that hurt others. These are the stress makers that can melt the will of even the best leaders, especially the leader who thinks popularity and leadership are brothers in love. JROTC is one of the greatest innovations in American education, where cadets grades 9 through 12 lead their peers in the midst of social media and the ever-present pressure to be popular. JROTC teaches that character, respect, and true leadership have nothing in common with popularity-seeking behavior. And with that as a backdrop, let's go back to the spectrum of fear. I'm talking to the cadets now. Please be honest with me. I want you to raise your hands high. Who thought that fear of failure was your greatest fear? Raise them high. That's commendable. Thank you. Be honest with me now. Who would think loss of popularity is one of your highest fears? That's even more commendable. Did anyone list the fear of God as one of your fears? Oh yeah. This is my group here. Okay, I'll give you my top five. My top one is the fear of God, because his power is limitless. Limitless. He cannot be deceived. And he controls all the other consequences that we must face as a result of our sin, as you were. Fear of God appears 130 times in the Holy Bible. My second greatest fear is failure. It used to be losing when I was an athlete. I never learned to lose. I'm a horrible loser. I still compete in everything I do. But failure is my greatest fear. Next, the fear of God. Loss of self-respect and respect from others. To be viewed as one who lacks integrity. That is a great fear. Addiction of any kind. I have one near addiction. I love cigars. And I have to fight that about every couple of years. I have to quit for a couple of years before I go back. And of course, the other fear is debt. I experienced that once as a young officer when I was making a house payment and bought an expensive new car I couldn't afford. I've not had a new car since 1973. Okay, cadets, I'm close to finishing, but I want to segue into some advice and counsel for you. If you haven't heard a thing I've said, listen now, because this is the core of my guidance to you. First, I hope that you learn early that you have never failed until you quit. In every battle or life's challenge, there is a time when you sense you might lose or fail. The realization often comes in a minor form of panic. You must overcome. I hope you become frustrated and challenged enough to begin to push back the barriers of your own self-perceived personal limitations. I hope you will make a blatant mistake and be big enough to say the words, "I was wrong. I am responsible." I hope you will recognize the difference between opinions and convictions. Convictions we fight for. Opinions we toss around loosely. I hope that you will early on work for demanding leaders who reward men and women who do what is expected and more. I hope for you a full measure of impatience for your own success. I hope you understand that everything in life that is worthwhile is hard. Achievements that come easy are rarely worth your time. I hope you feel the consequences of even the slightest breach of your integrity, because it is the consequences that ultimately define our character. I hope that you develop a self-awareness early. Display your strengths and hide your weaknesses as you work diligently to eliminate them. Never offer alibis for your failures, nor accept them from others who work for you. Remember, there is no right way to do the wrong thing. I hope that you will associate with others who possess strong character and personal values. Bring no one into your confidence that does not possess both. I hope that as a leader, when in doubt relative to critical decisions, you will decide, move on, and never look back. I wish for you the worst kind of criticism, because it is criticism that pushes us to stretch for greater achievements. And I wish for you the strongest faith in God, and that his will shall be done in your lives. So in closing, you are the fortunate sons and daughters. You live in the land of opportunity, but you must find the key to the gate. And that gate is education. But you're fortunate because your parents made a significant decision to send you to a military boarding school that is changing your expectations. We are not so interested in preparing you for a job, but for a life characterized by positions of leadership and countenance over others. The development of your character and your leadership is our mantra. First character and then leadership. After all, what use is a leader without a foundation of self-discipline, integrity, poise and confidence, and selfless devotion to your charges? And how we will insist that our cadet leaders avoid the character tripwires of drugs, alcohol, vulgarity, arrogance, and selfishness. If we fail, drip, drip, drip goes your character, and the leadership is no more. Rank and position in the corresponding leadership positions, corresponding leadership responsibility are not about privilege. They're not about private rooms or decorated uniforms. They're about the respect for others. They're not about popularity. You must be a leader of deeds, not words. As the great Georgia Governor George Zell Miller once wrote, "I stand for equal opportunity, special privilege for none." Our country is begging for ethical leaders for tomorrow. I'm not seeing many on cable news, and I sure don't see them at the mall. Why not you? A great friend and legendary Tennessee coach used to say, "You can, you must, you will succeed." God bless, and Semper Fidelis.